faces rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away.
Yeah.
Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, holds within the veil. Oh, my anchor holds within the veil. Oh, Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the same.
Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, we want to thank you, Lord, that the day that you made your triumphant entry into Jerusalem, where crowds of people shouted and proclaimed and declared, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. We thank you, Lord, that you have made that entry into Jerusalem and that you have completed the task for each and every one of us. And even as we remember that day, we want to thank you, Lord, that you have sacrificed yourself to die on the cross for each and every one of us. Today, as we remember that special entry that you made into Jerusalem, we ask and pray, Lord, that you continue to search our hearts, that we continue to be appreciative of what you have done on the cross for us. That even as we remember that journey into Jerusalem, we will not take our lives for granted and will continue to appreciate and be thankful for what you have done for all of us on the cross. Lord, even this morning, even as we come together as a church, wherever we may be, we continue to pray, Lord, for the present situation of the COVID-19 pandemic, Lord. We ask and pray, Lord, that everything will be under control. Even as the MCO is being implemented, we ask and pray that each and every Malaysian citizen will comply to follow this order so that the whole situation of this coronavirus will be brought under control. Yes, Lord, we continue to pray, Lord, for those who have been affected. We ask for your healing touch to be upon each and every one of them. We ask for your protection to be upon the doctors, the nurses, the support staff who are working continuously around the clock to help those who have been affected. We also ask and pray, Lord, for your spirit of comfort to be upon those who have lost their loved ones. Lord, we continue to commit our country into your hands. We ask and pray even in times like this, even in times where our movements have been restricted and businesses closed, we ask and pray that will continue to take care of our country's economy. Yes, Lord, we commit all of this into your hands. We ask and pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Today's scripture reading is on Luke chapter 19, verse 28 to 44. After Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going to Jerusalem. As he approached Bethphage and Bethany at the hill called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, Go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one had ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, why are you untying it? Say, the Lord needs it. Those who were sent ahead and went and found it just as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, why are you untying the colt? They replied, the Lord needs it. They brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks on the colt and put Jesus on it. As he went along, people spread the cloaks on the road. When he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, Teacher, rebuke your disciples. I tell you, he replied, if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out. As he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it and said, If you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace, but now it's hidden from your eyes. The days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment against you and encircle you and hem you in on every side. They will dash you to the ground, you and the children within your walls. They will not leave one stone on another because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you. This is the word of the Lord.
Very good morning to all of you who is watching this at home. I pray and hope that all of you are keeping well and keeping safe. May the presence of God be with all of you. This morning we are meeting again to hear God's word delivered to us, and once again, I believe we will not go away disappointed. But first, let us come before the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Father, thank you for watching over us for the past week. As we gather to listen to your word, speak to us, O gracious God. And as we hear, may your Holy Spirit work within us to produce the fruit that will glorify you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. A little boy was sick on Palm Sunday, and so he stayed home with his mummy. And then daddy came back from church holding some palm branches. The little boy was very curious and asked, "Daddy, what is this palm branch that is in your hand?" And daddy replied, "You see, Jesus came to town and everyone wanted to honor him, and they wave palm branches in honor of him. And that's why we get palm branches today." And the boy replied, "Oh man, the only Sunday where I'm not in church, Jesus turns up." Well, maybe the little boy got a little bit confused about Palm Sunday. Well, indeed, the scripture teaches us that on Palm Sunday, the Sunday before Easter, Jesus did enter into the city of Jerusalem. He went to town, indeed. And as he went in, riding on a donkey, people were praising him. They were waving palm branches and laying down their cloaks for him to walk upon as he rode on that donkey. This is a royal reception for Jesus. It is as good as saying that Jesus is King. Welcome, King. You know, any person who has been received with such wonderful and grandiose reception will think that, wow, this is such a great occasion, will feel so happy and proud. But you know, Jesus' response was so different. In Luke chapter 19, verse 41, this was said about Jesus. As he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it. Here, my friends, in the midst of the triumphal entry, what was Jesus' reaction? He looked over the city and he wept over it. Friend, on Palm Sunday, Jesus revealed to us something about God's heart. And the first thing that we learn is this, that God desires peace for his people. God desires peace for his people. Jerusalem, the city that Jesus was overlooking as he wept, the name of Jerusalem basically means the city of peace. 1,000 years ago, before Jesus came, David named the city, city of peace. But Jesus in verse 42 said this, "If you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace, but now is hidden from your eyes." What does it mean? Why is the city of peace is without peace? First of all, let's look at why David named Jerusalem the city of peace. Before King David was a king named Saul, and Saul came from the tribe of Benjamin. When David came and became king, there was kind of a bad blood between these two tribes, between Judah and Benjamin. And in order to bring reconciliation between people of these two tribes, David decided to pick this place, Jerusalem, which is located right at the border between Judah and Benjamin. It was a city chosen to symbolize reconciliation between these two cities, where even though there is a transfer of kingship, the people of Benjamin were not neglected. It was a city that is located high above, that has its own water source. It was a very secure city. But friends, by the time of Jesus, as he spoke those words, Jerusalem was no longer a city of peace. it is a city of wailing. For the 1,000 years before Jesus came, Jerusalem went through a very, very tough time. They were delivered into the hands of the conquerors, from Babylonians to Assyrians to Persians and now to the Romans. The city that was once a city of peace, a city of security, were no longer having that peace that it really required. Jesus wept because God longed for this peace to be restored to his people, to be restored to Jerusalem. And here God has sent Jesus. Jesus is the peace that God has brought to his people to reconcile them with God. Jesus is the peace that will bring about the reign of God, not only over Jerusalem, over all around the world. But yet, the people could not recognize when the peace of God is given to them. They actually rejected that peace that God had longed to give them. That is why Jesus wept. Jesus longs to give us peace, just as then he longed to give the peace to the city of Jerusalem. Jesus says this in John 14:27, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." Just as then, Jesus longs for us to receive reconciliation and peace with God. Jesus longs for us to have security in times of trouble. The same Jesus that wept as he saw Jerusalem is the same Jesus who knows when we are troubled and when we are deprived of peace. Even when Jerusalem did not realize, Jesus knew what they truly needed, what was their deepest longing. Friends, I pray that this will become your comfort, that Jesus knows when we are troubled and when we are in need of peace. And Jesus invites us today to receive his peace, the peace that the world cannot give, that only he can give. Perhaps this moment, we just pause. We just pause and come to Jesus and say, "Jesus, you are my peace. You have come to me to offer me peace in times of trouble. Lord, help me to receive your peace, to receive you. Because, Lord, that is my greatest security, and you know it deep well." Secondly, when Jesus wept, it revealed that God mourns over hardened hearts. God grieves over hearts that are hard. When Jesus entered into Jerusalem, not everybody was happy about it. They were the religious people who knew all about the scriptures, who followed so strictly the law of God in order to honor God. But when God entered their city, they did not realize. Hear this, my friends, from Luke 19:39. This was the response of the religious people. Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." In another version, is Jesus, "Please ask your disciples to stop shouting. Stop all this nonsense." While people were giving honor to Jesus, the Son of God, and people were celebrating the coming King, the religious people said, "Stop all this nonsense." Why did Jesus weep? Jesus wept because he saw hardened hearts. Hardened hearts, my friends. Jesus looked around. Yes, there were many people who were very religious, who studied the Torah and lived each day for the Torah. But yet, they cannot recognize when the Son of God, the peace that God has sent to them, is right in front of them. Jesus looked around. He looked at the temple. He saw so much of religious activities, but all done in the name of God. But yes, yet it is an opportunity to take advantage of people. That's why Jesus says, why do you turn the temple from a house of prayer into a den of thieves? So much of religious activities in the name of God, but yet they were not done in sincerity. Jesus looked around. In the coming few days, everybody was so excited about the religious festival, Passover. Passover is the most important festival for the Jewish people. They were all geared up, all excited, getting their perfect lamb to be cooked for the Passover meal. Yet, they rejected the Lamb of God. What does it tell us, friends? High religiosity, low receptivity. So much of religion, so little of reception towards God. And when God saw that, God's heart mourned. God's heart was so deeply hurt because God is in their midst and they have rejected and ignored Him. There was an entrepreneur, a businessman who owned a shoe shop. And this man wanted to run an experiment. He put before his shop two identical shoes. And he put a sign on top and says, there is absolutely no difference between these two shoes. Both are exactly the same. But one is priced at $6.95 and another is priced at $12.95. We just want to see which price will you choose. And guess what? Three out of the four customers decided and insisted that they will buy the shoe for $12.95 because they believe that this is a trick. There must be something different between these two shoes. Friends, so many people will believe and think only what they want. Even when things are before them, truths are before them, they do not want. They just want to hold on to what they believe, to what they think is right. My friends, this is a warning for us. We can be doing many religious things, high religiosity, but low receptivity. Maybe we may not be very much different from the religious people in Jesus' time. Do we go about doing our own things, living the way we want to live, thinking the way we want to think, because we think that we are right? Because that's exactly the attitude of the Pharisees. They always think that they are right. Only their interpretation of the law is correct. And they find that Jesus is not the Savior. Why? Because they say so. Friends, is your heart receptive to God? Is my heart receptive to God? Are we only high on religion, but low on receptivity? Or are we high in our devotion to the Lord because we are high in our receptivity towards God? Friends, what is the key to be receptive to God? The key is to listen to God. Let me repeat this. The key to have a receptive heart towards the things of God is to listen to God. Dr. Charles Swindoll is a pastor and a famous author. And he shared this about his own life much younger, in the earlier days of his ministry. At one period of time, he was overwhelmed with the number of commitments he had made, with very little days to commit, to complete that commitment. So he was feeling very tense, very stressed up. And because he was so tense and stressed up, he actually made everybody in his house very stressed and very tensed up. He began to speak very impatiently with his children. He snapped at his wife. You know, a little bit of interference, he will like scold and he will frown. You know, within a very short period of time, the whole household was so tense. One evening, his daughter Colleen ran to him and said, "Daddy, Daddy, I want to tell you something. Something happened in school," and she was very excited to tell her daddy. But she said, "Daddy, Daddy, let me tell you this, and I'll tell you very, very fast, okay?" Why? Because she was already feeling very tense with the environment due to Daddy. Swindle realized how exasperated the daughter and how frustrated the daughter was. And so she said to her, "Honey, hold on. You don't need to speak fast. Speak slowly. Speak slowly." And the daughter replied, this is something that he will never forget. The daughter replied, "Then, Daddy, listen slowly. Listen slowly." The key to a receptive heart is to listen slowly to the Lord. Not just listening, but there is a quality to listening. That is listening slowly. How do we do that? Firstly, when you read God's word, don't hurry. You know, sometimes we come before the Lord, before His word, and we read it and as if you're telling God, "God, please hurry up. Please tell me what I need to do, what I need to hear, so that I can do my journaling and get on with it." Do we come before the Lord hurriedly? Even before the Lord can utter, our hearts are not ready to hear. Even He has prepared something beautifully, wonderfully to say to us. So friends, this week, when you read the Word of God, read it slowly. Let your heart meditate upon it. Do not hurry. Do not rush God. Because if you tell God, "Speak slowly," then God is telling you, "Please listen slowly." Secondly, when you pray, listen patiently for His voice. God longs to speak to you, my friends. God longs to speak to us. When we pray, it is a mutual conversation. You speak to the Lord hears tenderly. But when the Lord wants to speak to you in prayer, do you hear tenderly, patiently? Friends, this is something that doesn't happen overnight. We need to learn to practice to listen patiently for the Lord's voice. But if you do and you practice being still and just wait upon the Lord, I guarantee you, friends, you will hear the Lord like never before. It will blow your mind what the Lord is able to say to you in your time of prayer. And you find prayer is not boring. Prayer is so engaging. Prayer is so enlightening. Prayer changes you. Thirdly, listen slowly to the Lord by observing the nature. Perhaps this is the best time, as we stay home, that we look outside of our house in a garden to the sky, for the Lord will choose to speak to us at times through the nature. Listen to what the scripture says. Psalm 19 verses 1, it says, "The heaven declares the glory of God, and the skies proclaim the work of His hands." Look up to the sky. What does it say to you about God, about the Creator of heaven and earth? What about this verse from Job 12, 7 to 9? "But ask the animals and they will teach you, or the birds in the sky and they will tell you, or speak to the earth and it will teach you, or let the fish in the sea inform you. Which of all this does not know that the hand of the Lord has done this?" Friends, one evening as I stayed home, probably around 3 something or 4 o'clock, usually I'll be in an office doing work and preparing for things and talking to people. But that evening, because of this MCO, I was at home. And it just rained and the sky just cleared. And as I was doing my work at home, I suddenly hear loud chirpings of birds. Unusual. Usually I do hear some chirping, but loud chirping. And so I went outside. There were so many birds that were just flying across at eye level. They were flying low. And I could see the different species of birds flying around. And it tells me, we are so worried and concerned because of the circumstances that we are in due to this coronavirus. But I see these birds flying around freely without a care in the world. Friend, it teaches me to cast my cares on the Lord, as these birds have learned it without people teaching them. Friends, much the nature can teach us about the Lord if we learn to listen slowly to what the creation has to tell us about the living God. Fourthly, listen slowly to Him through the circumstances He has placed you in. There will be many firsts for us in this situation, this COVID-19 situation that we are in. There will be many firsts. Many things that we have never encountered before in our workplace, at our homes, where we have to adapt due to the circumstances. But the many firsts may be God's way of teaching us, of telling us, of nurturing us. If we pay attention and ask the Lord, Lord, what is it that you want to teach me? What is it that you want to show me? The Lord will never refuse to teach us. Seek Him while He is near, and He'll be found. So friends, do not shun this opportunity to grow, to learn, even when times are tough, because these are the best lessons that will pull you through many other seasons that will come after this. Thirdly, Jesus weeping revealed God's heart breaks over terrible impending judgment. You see, Jesus already knew that 70 years after this, in AD 70, the Romans is going to invade the city of Jerusalem. And this time, the invasion will come in a terrible manner. They will come and they will destroy the city. Many people will be killed. In fact, almost 500,000 will be killed. And then the walls will be broken down, and the temple will be burned down. This will happen 70 years later, after Jesus oversaw that city and wept over it. And Jesus wept because His heart pains for the suffering of the people. But this judgment that God will bring upon Jerusalem is a judgment for the result of them rejecting God. And that's the problem with Jerusalem. Jerusalem became a city of wailing because they constantly reject when God offers His peace, when God offers His solution, because of their stubbornness, their rebellion against God, their unwillingness to submit to God's solution, that they have to suffer the consequences of their own action. So this is what will happen, my friends. They will have to face the consequences of them rejecting Jesus, who have come in that morning into the city of Jerusalem to bring them peace and the rule of God. The consequence is they will have to reap what they sow. Listen to Luke chapter 19, 43 to 44. The days will come upon you when your enemies will build upon embankment against you and encircle you and then and hem you in on every side. They will dash you to the ground, you and the children within your walls. They will not leave one stone on another because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you. Friends, there is a consequence when we reject God, when we ignore God, when we forsake God's solution for our lives, and we choose to do things on our own, and we will have to suffer and face the consequence of our own action. But God's heart breaks. And I want to illustrate this with a story about my friend. My friend has a lovely daughter, 3 years old. And she was trying to teach her 3-year-old daughter about discipline and obedience. The 3-year-old daughter is taught to put her dirty laundry, her clothes, into the laundry basket. But this little girl doesn't want to learn. She deliberately takes her clothes and throw it right outside the basket. She will take the clothes to the basket near the washing machine, and then she will throw right outside the basket. The mother was very patient. She tried to teach this little girl the importance of doing it right. And whenever the girl refuses, mommy has to punish so that she knows that this is wrong. So mommy tried. She tried to put her at the quiet corner. The little girl was sent there with tears rolling in her eyes, sobbing, upset. It makes mommy's heart break as well, but mommy has to do it. But that the girl still did the same thing. Mommy tried taking away the treats, take away her favorite toy, take away the favorite time that she used to watch her favorite cartoon. But each time, including spanking her backside, the little girl still refuses to do what the mommy has said. This went on for a few days. And finally, one night, my friend went into her room and she wept. She cried because she had to punish her child, and the child is so stubborn, refusing to learn, and she was going out of her mind. She didn't know what else to do. She's thinking, I'm going to bring up a child that is so willful that she will soon become an adult that will hurt herself because of her own wrong choices. But as she was crying, weeping, the little girl saw from the little gap between the doors. And guess what? The little girl went to the laundry room, picked up the dirty clothes that she had thrown on the floor, and placed it back into the basket. From that day onwards, the little girl never did throw the clothes, any of the cloth on the floor. She has always threw it back to the right place, to the basket. The little girl knew how much it hurt mommy because of her stubborn action, and how much it was hurting herself too. And she changed her mind, and she changed her ways. Friends, are we stubborn? Are we stubborn with certain of our own ways, certain habits, and certain things that we ought not to be doing, that we give ourselves excuses, reason after reason, but we know deep in our conscience, this is not right. It's not right for me to do like this. It's not right for me to think like this. It's not right for me to keep saying things like this. But are we repentant? Are we truly sorry? Do we realize how much it's hurting God? Because it's hurting ourselves and we have to reap the consequences? Don't we think that our things that we do in darkness will not be seen? Don't we think that every lie that we say and every action that is wrong will not come back to us and haunt us? It will. Because God is righteous. So friends, if we know how much God mourns for us and how much we will have to suffer if we continue in our stubbornness, in our own ways that's not pleasing before God, then friends, we may end up hurting both ourselves and hurting God. So today is the day, my friends. Let us not wait. Let us change. Let us let it be the little girl who will not resist God's teaching in our lives. And let us say, yes, God, by your grace, I will let go of this bad habit. I will allow you to help me to change. Fourthly, Jesus' weeping reminds us of God's unfailing love. Jesus weeps for the people who rejected him, but whom he loved very much. You don't cry over something that you don't love, that you don't care for. You just say, let you be. Hear these words of Jesus in Matthew 23, verse 37. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you, how often I have longed to gather your children together, and as a hen gathers her chick under her wings, and you were not willing. How often I have longed to gather you and your children. Jesus, out of his great love, wanted to gather his people to him. Why? Because in Christ, one finds security, one finds rest, one finds peace and life in God. How Jesus in his great love longed to gather his children, to gather us, just as a hen gathers a chick under his wings. Many times, Jesus does not give up to pursue people even when they are stubborn. But hear this, you were not willing. You were not willing. So friends, it tells us about God's love for us. God's love is relentless. He pursues us again and again and again, even without us receiving him. Isn't that amazing? Does that not tell us about God's great love for us? Jesus, who weeps out of love for Jerusalem, weeps out of love for you and I. Friends, God loves us very much. And this Palm Sunday, let's be reminded that Jesus entered into Jerusalem knowing exactly what he's into, that he had to suffer in the hands of evil men. He has to die. But yet he knows for the third day, he will rise from the dead and redeem us out of the depth of our sin to give us a second chance. Friends, this is God's relentless love. Jesus' relentless love for you and I. This is the best time today to reflect that despite all hardship and difficulties that we may have to face, God still loves us. And because of Jesus' great love for us, we can rest securely that He will continue to gather us into His loving arms, into security. But friends, Jesus' love is not only for us, it's also for others. And many people out there, in this time where they are at home, maybe perhaps alone, by themselves, so fearful, they need to know also that Jesus loves them too. And how can they know the love of Jesus? It's through us. I invite all of us in this season where we are called to stay home, we use this opportunity of time to reach out to many of our friends or family members. This is a time that we reach out to them to care for them, because when they feel care, that is where the love of God will go to them. Perhaps some of them may need some care, some practical forms of care like provision, or maybe they need us to help out to get some of their medicine. Whatever it is that we can do within our means, this is the time, my friends. This is the time to pick up that phone and make that call. This is the time to send that WhatsApp message. This is the time to video call. This is the time to catch up. This is the time to channel God's love to others. So friends, let us be reminded of Palm Sunday, the Sunday where God wept for each and every one of us, for Jerusalem, for His people. And it only tells us of how wonderful God is. And in this season of time, let us make this full opportunity to draw near to God, to fix our eyes on the Lord who wept for us out of great love for us. Let us pray. Father, we want to thank you and praise you. We want to thank you, O God, for the day Jesus entered into Jerusalem and revealed to us your heart. It tells us, O God, that how much, O Lord, you mourn for the hardness of our hearts. How, O God, you desire and long for peace to come into our lives. How you desire, O God, to prevent us from hurting ourselves, facing the consequences of our stubbornness. And how, O Lord, you long to gather us, to love us, and to allow us to have fullness of life. Lord, we thank you and praise you for your wonderful message. May this season of MCO be a time that we use this message not only for ourselves, but for those who are around us. May they too experience the perfect love of the Father through our Lord Jesus Christ. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my. Thank you.
And now let us receive God's benediction. May the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the peace that surpasses all understanding, guard over your hearts and your minds from today till eternity. Amen.
Shine like the sun.